Hi students, today I am here with crystal field theory, or in short CFT, which gives you good information about bonding in coordination complexes. In our last video, we studied about VBT or valence bond theory, which was also proposed to explain bonding in coordination complexes. See, according to valence bond theory, the bond present between metal and ligand was coordinate bond. As you all know, coordinate bond is also a type of covalent bond in which sharing of electrons takes place between metal and ligand. But this valence bond theory had its own drawbacks. To overcome all those drawbacks, the new theory, that is crystal field theory, was proposed. So let's see what is meant by crystal field theory. According to crystal field theory, the metal ligand bond is considered to be purely ionic in nature. As you all know, ionic bond is the force of attraction between positive charge and negative charge. In case of coordination complexes, the metal is considered as point positive charge. As you all know, metal ions always have positive charge. Examples for metal ions are cobalt ion, nickel ion, etc. Similarly, ligands are considered as point negative charges. For example, chloride, bromide, etc. All these act as ligands. Now you may have a doubt. There are even ligands like water, ammonia, etc. which are neutral. So how can you consider them as point negative charges? Well, your question is valid, but we have an answer for that. See, in case of neutral ligands like ammonia or water, okay, let's consider ammonia only. There you have negatively charged nitrogen. Or in simple words, nitrogen has more electronegativity when compared to hydrogen. That's why nitrogen develops partial negative charge over it and hydrogen develops partial positive charge. Now you can call it as a dipole. Why? Because in a single molecule we have two poles. One is negative pole, other one is positive pole. Now when this dipole comes in contact with metal, there will be ionic interaction between metal ion and negative end of the dipole. Similarly, in the case of water, you have more electronegative oxygen. So that develops partial negative charge over it, and hydrogen will have partial positive charge. So the negative end of the dipole gets attracted towards positively charged metal ion. Hence again, ionic bond is created there. This is the main principle behind crystal field theory. Using this information, let's study the postulates of crystal field theory. As I already said, here is the first postulate, that is metal ligand bond is considered to be ionic in nature according to crystal field theory. Because metal ion is considered as point positive charge, negatively charged ligands are considered as point negative charges. And if you have neutral ligands like water or ammonia, they are considered as dipoles. In case of dipole, what happens? Negative end of the dipole gets attracted towards positively charged metal ion. So as a result of attraction between oppositely charged species, ionic bond is formed. Okay, I hope one thing is clear to you. That is, opposite charges attract each other, whereas like charges or similar charges repel each other. As you know, ligands are negatively charged species. When more number of ligands approach the central metal ion, there could be repulsion between them, correct? No? To avoid that, what they do? So here is the third postulate for that. The negatively charged ligands are arranged around the metal ion in such a manner that repulsion between them is minimum. So the distance between the ligands will be maximum, so that repulsion between them will be minimum. So that will be the arrangement of ligands around the central metal ion. One more point, students. The D subshell has 5 orbitals, right? In a free metal ion, that means in a metal ion in which ligands are not present, or the metal ion which is not surrounded by any ligands, all the 5 d orbitals will have same energy. That is, in the absence of ligands, all the metal d orbitals will have same energy. That condition of having same energy is called as degeneracy, and the metal orbitals are said to be degenerate d orbitals. But as the ligands approach the central metal ion, what happens? There could be repulsion between electrons present in the d orbitals of metal and electrons of the ligands. So electron-electron repulsion can happen. Now consider a case like this. Here we have the free metal cation in which all the d orbitals have same energy. And here we have another case in which the ligands are approaching the metal ion in a spherically symmetrical manner. In such a case, the field produced by the ligand will also be symmetrical. That means what happens? All the d orbitals of the metal experience repulsion to the same extent. So, if the ligands approach the metal ion in a spherically symmetrical manner, the ligand field will also be symmetrical. Hence, all the metal d orbitals are repelled to the same extent. And whenever there is repulsion, the energy of the system increases. So, it can be diagrammatically shown like this. So, here we have degenerate d orbitals of free metal ion. That means in the absence of ligands. But when the ligands approach the metal ion in a spherically symmetrical manner like this, the energy of these orbitals increase because of repulsion. But still, even in the higher energy state, they will be degenerate only. So here we have degenerate d orbitals of metal ion in the presence of spherical ligand field. But practically, in coordination complexes, ligands will never approach the central metal ion in such a spherically symmetrical manner. So it is possible only theoretically. So actually the ligands approach the central metal ion from different directions or unsymmetrically. That's why the ligand field produced will also be unsymmetrical only. So this kind of situation is not happening now. When the ligands are approaching the metal in an unsymmetrical manner, the d orbitals of the metal which are closer to the incoming ligands will experience more repulsion and they are raised in energy. That means their energy will increase. As you know, whenever there is more repulsion, the energy increases. Whereas the d orbitals which are away from the incoming ligands, they will experience less repulsion. So now you can say, due to the ligand field, the degenerate d orbitals of the metal split into two sets like this. One set of orbitals will have higher energy because they are more closer to the incoming ligands and they are experiencing more repulsion. And the other set of orbitals which are away from the incoming ligand, they are experiencing less repulsion. That's why their energy will be less when compared to this set. So, splitting of degenerate d orbitals of the metal in the presence of ligand field can be called as crystal field splitting. So I hope you understood the reason behind crystal field splitting. When the ligands approach the central metal ion in an unsymmetrical manner, the electrons present in the d orbitals of metal, which are found closer to the incoming ligands, they experience more repulsion. That's why their energy will increase. And the d orbitals of metal, which are found away from the incoming ligand, they experience less repulsion. That's why their energy will decrease. Hence, two sets of orbitals are produced. This is called as crystal field splitting. Now we'll study crystal field splitting in octahedral complexes. Okay, I'll draw the diagram of an octahedral complex now. Initially, you will have a square plane like this, at the center of which metal ion is present. And four ligands will be present at the corners of these square plane like this. So four ligands are present like this. You can consider this as x-axis. Perpendicular to that you have, you have y-axis. So x and y-axis are present in one plane and you have two more ligands perpendicular to this plane like this. You can consider this as z-axis. So this is an octahedral complex in which central metal ion is present at the center of this square plane. Four ligands are arranged along x and y axis. Two more ligands are arranged along z axis. Remember students, in octahedral complex, the ligands approach the central metal ion along three axis. Now to understand this concept clearly, let's see the structure of 5d orbitals. As you know, the 5 d orbitals are dxy, dyz, dzx, dx square minus y square and dz square. So dxy orbital, it involves x-axis and y-axis. As you can see from the diagram, the orbitals of dxy are found in between x-axis and y-axis. Coming to dyz, here the lobes of the dyz orbital are found between y-axis and z-axis. Similarly, dzx, here the orbitals are found aligned in between x-axis and z-axis. Coming to the next type, dx square minus y square. Here also x-axis and y-axis are involved, but what is the difference? Here the lobes of this dx square minus y square orbital, they are found along x-axis and y-axis. If you come to dz square, here all the three axes are involved, x, y and z, but the major portion of the orbital is aligned along z-axis. You have a very small portion of dz square along x and y. But still the name is dz square because major portion of the orbital is found along z axis only. So the first three orbitals are found in between the axis, whereas the next two orbitals are found along the axis. That is the major difference. I have written the same thing here. The dxy, dyz and dzx orbitals lie in between the axis, whereas the dx square minus y square and dz square orbitals lie along the axis. Again, from this diagram, in an octahedral complex, it is found that the six ligands approach the central metal ion along the three axes, that is along x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. So it is not a spherically symmetrical approach. Remember, the ligands are coming along the axis. Now, the dx square minus y square and dz square orbitals, that is these two orbitals, they are found along the axis. That means you can say these two orbitals are closer to the incoming ligands. That means they are repelled to greater extent. Whenever there is repulsion, what happens to energy? Energy increases. Whereas the other three orbitals, dxy, dyz and dzx, these three orbitals, they are found in between the axes. That means they point between negatively charged ligands. So they are not in the direction of incoming ligands. So you can say they are repelled to lesser extent when compared to dx square minus y square and dz square orbitals. Hope you understood this one. So let's explain it diagrammatically, which is very important for your exam. Here initially we have 5 degenerate d orbitals of metal ion, that is a free metal ion in the absence of ligands. If at all the ligands approach the central metal ion in a spherically symmetrical manner, all the 5 d orbitals will be repelled to same extent. Hence, their energy will increase. So you can consider this as average energy of the d orbitals in spherical crystal field, but practically it is not possible. Practically what happens? In an octahedral complex, the ligands are approaching along the axis. So two of the d orbitals, dx square minus y square and dz square, which are aligned along the axis, they will experience more repulsion due to the electrons of incoming ligand. Hence their energy will increase. Whereas the other three orbitals, dxy, dyz and dzx, they are found in between the axes. That means they are not in the direction of incoming ligands. Hence, they experience less repulsion. So, when compared to the average energy, their energy will be less. Now, the energy difference between Eg and T2g orbitals is represented by delta O. O is for octahedral complex. Okay, I didn't tell you what is meant by Eg and T2g, right? These two orbitals, dx square minus y square and dz square orbitals, which are found along the axis, are represented by a spectroscopic term Eg. And these three orbitals, triply degenerate orbitals, dxy, dyz, dzx, which are found in between the axis, they are represented by a spectroscopic term called T2g. So T2g is for these three orbitals, Eg is used for these two degenerate orbitals. So if you consider this as the average energy of the orbitals in the presence of ligands, from there the Eg orbitals will be increased in energy by an amount of 0.6 times delta O. Whereas the T2g orbitals will be decreased in energy by an amount of minus 0.4 delta O. So what is this delta O? It is known as crystal field stabilization energy. So it is the difference of energy between two sets of orbitals. So Eg orbitals are raised in energy by an amount of 0.6 delta O above the average energy level, whereas T2g orbitals, they are decreased in energy by an amount of minus 0.4 delta O below average energy level. Why do we have these two values, or what is the logic behind it? Let's see the answer. See students, in Eg we have two orbitals, in T2g we have three orbitals, right? As you know, one orbital can have a maximum of 2 electrons. Since we have 2 orbitals, 2 into 2 electrons. So, Eg can hold a maximum of 4 electrons. So, I told you, Eg is raised by an amount of 0.6 delta O. Now, 0.6 into 4 electrons, how much is it? It is 2.4 delta O, correct? No. Now T2g has 3 orbitals, each orbital can have 2 electrons. So 3 into 2, 6 electrons are possible in T2g. Therefore, minus 0.4 into 6 electrons, that is equal to how much? Minus 2.4. So this is plus 2.4, this is minus 2.4. If you add these two together, plus 2.4 minus 2.4, how much is it? 0. So average energy is maintained here. So how much ever amount of energy is increased by Eg, same amount of energy is decreased by T2g. So average energy of d orbitals is maintained at 0. Hence the complex remains. One last point. The extent of crystal field splitting depends upon type of ligand. And we have an experimentally studied arrangement of ligands in the order of their crystal field stabilization energy values. And that arrangement is called as spectrochemical series. Here is it. Iodide less than bromide less than sulfide, that is less than thiocyanate ligand, that is less than chloride, then fluoride, hydroxide, oxalate, oxo, water, isothiocyanate, amine, ethylene diamine, nitrito, cyanide and carbonyl. The ligands which are present to the left side of the spectrochemical series, they are said to produce smaller crystal field splitting. That's why they are called as weak field ligands. And those which are present to the right side of the series, they are said to produce larger crystal field splitting. That's why they are called as strong field ligands. Now we will see how are electrons filled in T2g and Eg orbitals. According to Aufbau principle, electrons are filled from lower energy orbital to higher energy orbital. So in this case, the T2g orbitals dxy, yz and zx orbitals are lower energy orbitals. That's why they are filled first. Then we have Hund's rule or Hund's rule. According to that, each orbital is singly filled first. Once all the degenerate orbitals get one electron each, two cases are possible. That is, once all these three orbitals are singly filled with electrons like this, two cases are possible. The next electron, fourth electron, may enter into higher energy Eg orbital, or the fourth electron can get paired with dxy orbital, that is electron present in the T2g orbital itself. So here are the two cases. The fourth electron can go to higher Eg orbital, or the next electron can pair with electron already present in the T2g orbital. So which one will happen, that depends upon two factors. First one is pairing energy. It is the energy required for pairing of electrons. So if you have an orbital like this, already you have an electron here, and another electron to pair with this electron requires some energy. So that is known as pairing energy. And second point is crystal field stabilization energy. You already know that it is the energy difference between T2g orbital and Eg orbital. So first case is, if pairing energy is greater than crystal field stabilization energy, the next electron prefers to go to Eg orbital. So what is it? The energy gap between T2g and Eg, that is crystal field stabilization energy, is very less when compared to energy required to undergo pairing. In such a condition, the fourth electron prefers to jump to Eg orbital only. In such a case, you will have more number of unpaired electrons. Whenever there is more number of unpaired electrons, you call it as high spin complex. And what is case 2? If pairing energy is lesser than crystal field stabilization energy, that means if the energy gap between T2g and Eg is very much high when compared to pairing energy, that electron prefers to sit in T2g orbital itself. So if pairing energy is lesser than crystal field stabilization energy, next electron prefers to pair up with electron already present in T2g. So you will be having less number of unpaired electron, that produces a low spin complex. So if you have weak field ligands, their crystal field stabilization energy will be lesser than pairing energy. That's why they produce high spin complexes. And if you have strong crystal field splitting, that's why crystal field stabilization energy will be greater than pairing energy. Hence, they produce low spin complexes. So that is about today's video. I hope you understood the concept of crystal field theory clearly. Thank you so much for watching.